2 and find Isaiah 62. Bless you. I'm going to read from them two places. I know I've got several places here marked down to read. If I get to them, it'll be good. And if not, I believe it'll work out. But just a few verses in Revelation 2 I want to read. Then I want to flip to Isaiah 62. Then we might just hold your place in Revelation. I'll probably go back there if there's any. I give everybody time to find out. I know this in Revelation 2. I read this not so long ago. I want to read just a couple verses there and then flip. Everybody's found it. Revelation chapter 2, just like I said, a couple verses here. Verse 16, 17 says, "Repent, or else I will come unto thee quickly and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden man, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saving he that received it." I just want to read them two verses right now, and I'll flip over to Isaiah in just a second. But you, some of you might remember a while back reading about the white stone, and I know a lot of you probably wasn't here at that time or whatever, may not even remember, but David mentioned this, and I went to dig and went and found and read some things about the white stone, and basically it comes down to being victorious. If you go back and study out on that white stone, it's symbolic then of being victorious. And that's just plain and simple how it is. He's a meaning that you live your life for Jesus, you're going to be victorious. And in the stone, a new name written, which no man knoweth, saving he that received it. It's been mentioned, and I like I said, a whole lot of times, sometimes things will get said that'll just click inside my head, and I can't get them off my mind. And I know for the last month or so, since like every meeting we've been in, it's been mentioned about a new name being written. And I went back to this verse this week and thinking about it, and with the studying and reading on some things about a new name, and if you will, I want to flip over to Isaiah 62 and read probably just about all this. Isaiah 62 verse 1 says, "For Zion's sake will I not hold my peace, and for Jerusalem's sake I will not rest until the righteousness thereof go forth as brightness, and the salvation thereof as a lamp that burneth. And the Gentiles shall see thy righteousness, and all kings thy glory. Thou shalt be called by a new name, which the mouth of the Lord shall name. Thou shalt also be a crown of glory in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of thy God. Thou shalt no more be turned forsaken, neither shall thy land any more be turned desolate, but thou shalt be called Hephzibah, and thy land Beulah, for the Lord delighteth in thee, and thy land shall be married. For as a young man marrieth a virgin, so shall thy sons marry thee. And as a bridegroom rejoiceth over the bride, so shall thy God rejoice over thee. I have set watchmen upon thy walls, O Jerusalem, which shall never hold their peace, day nor night. Ye that make mention of the Lord, keep not silence, and give him no rest till he establish, until he make Jerusalem a praise in the earth. The Lord has sworn by his right hand, and by the arm of his strength, surely I will no more give thy corn to be meat for thine enemies, and the sons of the stranger shall not drink thy wine, for the which thou hast labored. But they that have gathered it shall eat it and praise the Lord, and they that have brought it together shall drink it in the courts of my holiness. Go through the gate, prepare ye the way of the people, cast up the highway, gather out the stones, lift up a standard for the people. Behold, the Lord hath proclaimed unto the end of the world. Say ye to the daughter of Zion, behold, thy salvation cometh. Behold, his reward is with him, and his work before him. And they shall call them the holy people, the redeemed of the Lord. And thou shalt be called, sought out, a city not forsaken. I want to go back to Revelation here in just a minute. And I know it's a whole lot of reading. And it goes right along with Revelation, a whole lot of verses in Revelation. I may not read them all, but we'll get to a few of them. Verse 2, studying this out, and the Gentiles shall see thy righteousness, and all the kings thy glory, and thou shalt be called by a new name, which the mouth of the Lord shall name. Now, that's just two places I've done read in the Word of God that talks about a new name that the Lord's going to give you. There's several more verses in it. It ultimately comes right back down to really what Mitchell read this morning, and I was praying that God had confirmed what I'm supposed to read this morning. It comes back to, if you got any sort of knowledge, anything about the Bible, some of you just done a thinking about it. I already know that there's people in the Bible that had their name changed. As soon as they had an encounter with God or Jesus, they changed their name. That was symbolic. I always wondered that. Why did that happen when I read it in the Bible and God changed somebody's name? And I always wondered that. Well, it was symbolic. If you go back, if you recall any of this I just read, thou shalt no more be termed forsaken, neither shall thy land any more be termed desolate. You see, before a person's ever saved, you're already termed lost.
Come on.
You're already turned on your way to hell. You're already turned a child of the devil, which goes back to a few Sundays ago. When you have an encounter or an experience with Jesus Christ, things change. It goes back to walking in the newness of life. It's such a change. It's such an experience. You get a new name.
Come on.
And there's something about this name, and I got to thinking about it this week, some of you maybe I'm crazy and just thinking it's been mentioned, but I'm pretty sure it's been mentioned for several Sundays now. Somebody's mentioned a new name, and it just comes down to that's how powerful salvation really is. Everything changes so much that God gives you a new name. And there's something about this name, and if I can find it, because I've got so many about this new name and where it's going to be, not only in that white stone, but let's see here. Let's turn to Revelation chapter 14. Revelation chapter 14. Let me make sure. And I'll read just a few verses here. Revelation 14:1 says, "And I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his Father's name written in their forehead. And I heard a voice from heaven, as a voice of many waters, and as a voice of great thunders, and heard a voice of harpers harping with their harps. And they sung, as it were, a new song before the throne, before the four beasts and the elders, and that no man can learn that song, but the 144,000 which were redeemed from the earth. These are they which were not defiled with women, and for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits unto God and to the Lamb, and in their mouth was found no guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God." Now, I know there's a lot in this, and everybody's got questions and things about this verse of Scripture. The main thing you need to understand, verse 1 says, "Having his Father's name written in their foreheads." Now, I don't want to talk about this. That wasn't the point, but I'll just clarify this 144,000. It's got nothing to do with what the Jehovah's Witnesses think. It's not a pre-selected number that's a going. I believe in the Bible that numbers have a whole lot of meaning. The number 7 of being completion, number 6 of being the number of man. If you go back and read, I believe it's in Revelation about the 144,000 was 12,000 from each 12 tribes of the children of Israel.
Come on.
12 is just another number of completion. It means it's done. It means it was enough. Just like there was 12 apostles, there was 12 pearly gates. It means it's enough. So this 144,000 means that there was enough people. How many times have we heard David preach when he's a preacher and he hopes one more gets saved, the last one, so we can go on home? It'll be a completion. It's done. It's the all the redeemed of the earth. That's what he's talking about. But what it's to say, now that's out of the way. Like I said, having his father's name written in their foreheads. You see, this new name is going to be written in your forehead. It's not a man's not going to come along in a few days with a magic marker and write it. God's done wrote it. If you're saved this morning, it goes right back. And I want to say this too, for a couple of Sundays ago, about being a child of God or a child of the devil. You're marked one way or the other. Just so happens God marked us with a new name in our forehead. If you'll go back to several Sundays ago about the great whore of Babylon, she had an inscription in her forehead.
That's right.
Tell who she was. You see, we're all marked, and it's for a reason. You see, there's a couple of reasons that upon studying this, that I sort of see it as a couple of different reasons. One is because there's such a change in your life, and things are all new, that God will write that new name in your forehead. But it's for a reason. It's marked. You're marked, and if you will go back to Revelation. Let's see, Revelation 7. Well, I'm going to read that. I didn't mention this, but I'm going to read it anyway. It's going to be good. Revelation 7:1. Says, and after these things I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on any tree. And I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God, and he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea, and say, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. And I heard the number of them which were sealed, and there were sealed 144,000 in all the tribes of the children of Israel. Now, you go on, this is exactly what I said just a minute ago, Bob. 12,000 of the 12 tribes is what it's a meaning here. But verse 3 says, say, hurt not the earth, neither the sea nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. You see, it goes right back to the mark, to that new name, and you God of knowing whether or not you belong to Him. But it's for a reason, you see. It's a building up to God of fixing to destroy this place. And these scriptures, and if you look around, shortly everything has been preached and taught and said and talked about in this church, you know it's a fixing to come. And that's the main important thing this morning. You need to know whether or not you're marked by God this morning. You need to know whether or not you had such an experience in your life with Jesus, and it was enough for you to change so much that He gave you a new name.
Amen.
And it's for a reason. And you remember this verse of Scripture right here, and I want to go turn to Ezekiel chapter 9. I didn't know if I'd read this or not, or I'd have just turned to it.
Bless you, Lord.
Ezekiel chapter 9.
Let me make sure. Before I read that, let me make sure it's...
Yeah, Ezekiel chapter 9. Let me read quite a bit of this too. Verse 9 says, "He cried also in mine ears with a loud voice, saying, cause them that have charge over the city to draw near, even every man with his destroyed weapon in his hand. And behold, six men came from the way of the higher gate, which lieth toward the north, and every man a slaughter weapon in his hand, and one man among them was clothed with linen, with a rider's inkhorn by his side, and they went in and stood beside the brazen altar. And the glory of the Lord and the glory of the God of Israel was gone up from the cherub whereupon he was to the threshold of the house, and he called to the man clothed with linen, which had the rider's inkhorn by his side. And the Lord said unto him, go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and set a mark upon the foreheads of the men that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst thereof. And to the others he said in mine ear, go ye after him through the city, and smite, let not your eyes spare, neither have ye pity. Slay utterly old and young, both maids and little children and women, but come not near any man upon whom is the mark, and begin at my sanctuary. Then they began at the ancient men which were before the house, and he said unto them, defile the house, and fill the courts with the slain. Go ye forth. And they went forth and slew in the city. And it came to pass, while they were slaying them, I was left, and I fell upon my face and cried, and said, O Lord God, wilt thou destroy all the residue of Israel in thy pouring out of thy fury upon Jerusalem? Then said he unto me, the iniquity of the house of Israel and Judah is exceeding great, and the land is full of blood, and the city full of perverseness. For they say, the Lord hath forsaken the earth, and the Lord seeth not. And as for me also, mine eyes shall not spare, neither will I have pity, but I will recompense their way upon their head. And behold, the man clothed with linen, which had the inkhorn by his side, reported the matter, saying, I have done as thou hast commanded me. Now, whether or not you know anything about the book of Ezekiel, there's a lot of prophetic Old Testament prophets that wrote down things that God showed them, and I believe this is one of them. And if you've never read the book of Ezekiel, I encourage you to go and read it. This is pretty self-explanatory scriptures, that is, it's sending the men out to slay the ones that didn't have the mark. It's symbolic as the things which is fixing to happen. Everything I've done read, going back to Revelation, tell them not to hurt the earth before they've sealed the servants of God in their foreheads. Right here he's just saying, don't you go through and set a mark upon the foreheads of the men that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst thereof. Everybody else was to be killed. You see, what's a fixing to happen is one day, everything he's been a preaching on, everything he's been taught on, when the sky busts open and he comes back to gather us, it's going to be just like this right here. Everything's going to be destroyed, and the ones that are marked, God's going to look and say, you're mine, you're mine, you're mine. Yeah.
Amen.
You got to have that mark on you. You've got to have that experience with Jesus Christ to get that new name, to get that mark, to get that seal in your forehead. You see, it's all for him when he comes back. That way he can look at you just like these men are walking through the city. It wasn't going to hurt the ones that was marked. I thank God this morning, I'm not going to be hurt.
Come on.
I keep thinking about that verse here in Revelation. Hurt not nothing till all the servants of God see you. I'm waiting on that last one to get sealed up. You see, it goes right back to everything that's been taught and preached in this church. Do you belong to God or not? Because it's a fiction to be a sad, sad, sad day if you ain't marked. I believe as soon as he comes back, he's going to be important knowing which ones belong to him, which ones don't. One thing you need to pick out in this scripture right here, Set a mark upon the foreheads of the men that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst thereof. And you go on and read. One thing that stuck out in my mind that, where'd it go? About beginning in the sanctuary.
Come on.
I mean, you know, we can go out here in the street and in town and tell everybody we need to tell. We should go tell everybody to live our life for God and tell them what Jesus has done for us. But it needs to start right here. If you're not right with God and if you're not saved this morning, you need to fix that. It needs to start here. It's got to start with me. Yeah, I can't help nobody unless I help myself. I can't tell nobody else about needing to be marked if I don't feel like I'm marked myself. If I don't feel like God's done something for me enough to change my name, I can't tell you He can change yours. If I don't feel like God's given me a new life, how am I going to explain a new life to you? It needs to start here. Start the sanctuary. That goes right along with, this has been said many a time, and I'm going to say it again this morning, not everybody sitting in the church is going to go. Amen. I believe this scripture right here backs that up. You got to start in the sanctuary and go from there. These men was going through a killing these people. And they told them to start in the sanctuary and then go from there. That's a serious thing to me, Tom,
You know, brother, can I say something?
Go ahead, preacher.
Thanks so much for coming to my mind. Most people don't even understand what you're talking about. Did you know that?
Yeah.
But if you go over in Revelation, on over in the book, I'm not going to tell you where it's at. Praise God. You don't learn. I'm going to tell you the problem of America today. The preachers will quote the scripture. They'll tell you where it's at, and then you just take it for the truth. You'll never know it unless you search it out. But now listen, the Bible said that He was coming and He was looking for them that had His name written in their foreheads.
Yeah.
Now they talked about the mark of the beast and they talk about a lot of things, but the mark of the beast is literally the mark of sin. Sin will not enter into the kingdom of heaven. Now, that's Bible. Let's just get that right straight off the bat. That's Bible. Okay, this is where it starts at. Now this brother, amen, began to speak about the 144,000 over there standing with the Lamb of God, amen. And he began to talk about the witnesses of Christ. This is what, I've been on this all week, don't know why, I didn't know why this scripture is coming to my mind, but I do now. The Bible said over in Hebrews 12, verse 1, you don't have to turn because I'm fixing to get with this thing and it's going to move pretty quick. So you just listen and mark it down. The Bible said, wherefore seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that's set before us. Amen. God has never jerked anything out of anybody's hand. But God has never saved anybody and left them living like hell. Can I get an amen? Somebody say amen. I'm going to go right back to the beginning. If God will be my helper, and I'm going to go back to a verse this morning, amen, that Brother Mitchell got down to, and I thought, Lord, let him read the next verse. And God said, you read it. And I thought, when? Praise God, we're going to have church. You ready? Amen. Now let's go ahead and get with this thing. Amen. What we got during whatever, God's people was bound down with the Egyptians, and is in bondage. Amen. Praise be unto God. If you're living in sin, you're in bondage. You've never been set free. Amen. But whenever you get set free, sin has no more power over you. You've got victory over that thing. Amen. Praise God. When I was an alcoholic, I found down with alcoholism. But that Friday night, I met Jesus. And He saved my unworthy soul. I came out from under bondage and came victorious. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. The Bible said, amen, God told him in Egypt. He said, now you go and take it to your lamb. Put it up to the 14th day of the month and examine it. You know what he wanted them to do? To make sure it was the right one. To make sure it had no blemishes. It wasn't lame. It wasn't blind. But they took a pure lamb.
Lord have mercy.
Yeah.
Holding the book of Zechariah, praise God, amen. You wouldn't believe what I say. The Bible said Zechariah, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord, and the devil stood by and resisted him. And then the Lord said, rebuke thee, Satan. And the Bible said, amen, the Lord rebuked him. And he spoke to the angel, he said, take away his filthy garments, give him a change of raiment.
Yeah.
You know what, old Zechariah, God, he got the righteousness of God. Can I get an amen? The Bible said the angel of the Lord God spoke to him and told him, said, to place a fire miter upon his head. Amen. What people don't understand, praise God, when God saved a man, woman, boy, and a girl, amen, he cleans them from the sole of their feet to the top of their head. Can I get an amen? Not one place, brother, does God leave a blemish. Amen. Come on. And the Bible said the angel of the Lord told Mary, said, you're going to bear a son, and his name's going to be Jesus. And he will save his people from their sin. God don't save you and leave you laying like hell. He'll bring you out and make a new creature out of you, that the world can see the glory of an almighty God. You're a witness of God this morning, an ambassador of heaven. Praise God for Christ Jesus. I studied on that fire miter for years. Let me tell you what a fire miter is.
Bless you, Lord.
In the Webster Dictionary, this is the definition of a fire miter. It's a turban, or a headdress, or an inscription. Amen? God saved me one Friday night. He rode me up. Praise God. I got up a new deal. What Paul preached. He said, if any man be in Christ Jesus, he is a new creature.
Yeah.
Behold, all things are passed away. And behold, all things become new. Amen. Even my mind changed. I started thinking about things I didn't think about. I didn't want to do the things I used to do. Made me sick to even think about it. Praise God. It still does. Come on, praise God. But when you become a new creature, everything changes. The way you look, the way you talk, the places you go. Can I get an amen? Come on. Even the way you think. But that night I got an inscription, brother. It's right here, and it says, I belong to Jesus. And when he comes, he's going to be looking for his name, and I've got the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. Come on, praise God. The verse that I want to read that Mitchell got down to, and praise God, Mitchell didn't mean it. He didn't miss it, praise God. Amen. But what he read this morning stirred me up, and I thought, my God, look out. You know what? Repentance. I got something to preach here right a while. You better get ready. I've been on this thing for days, brother. The Bible said in the 16th verse. Now listen, I want you, every person in this church, to listen to what I'm saying. The Bible said, know ye not, the 16th verse, amen, of the 6th chapter of the book of Romans. He said, know ye not that to whom you yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom you obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. Now, I'm just going to be as honest with you as I know how. This brother began to read over in Isaiah, amen, about lifting up a standard before the people.
Amen.
Did you know there's a standard if you're a child of God?
Yeah. Amen.
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
America has left the standards of God.
Amen.
There's a way to act, a way to talk, a way to dress, a way to look, and places to go, the way God said to me. A new creature. You can't have sin in your life and say you belong, amen, to a risen Savior.
Listen.
Say, preacher, we're all failed. If you're a child of God, you're not a sinner. You're a born-again child of God.
Amen.
Come on. Man has used their own thoughts to make up things to where they've got an access to sin. Brother Mitchell done read it. Should we abide in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. The Bible said it. He read this morning. He said, how can we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? He said, Salvation's of the Lord. I've got a new name. I'm not the same person.
That's right.
So don't you struggle every day. Every day.
Yeah.
So don't you have struggles with the things of life? Sure do. Everybody does. Every person in this place has struggles. You're tempted every day, but Christ said, I made a way. A man with all temptations, he made a way of escape. God didn't make, he didn't save you and let you walk around here by yourself.
Amen.
He said, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, come unto me and I'll give you rest. Learn of me, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Can I get a name? Somebody ought to know what I'm preaching. Everybody wants to use an excuse. I'm weak. Well, the Bible said in our weakness, he's strong. Praise God, that ain't an excuse. Bible speaks about over in 1 John, amen, the 4th chapter, praise God, and he talked about the Antichrist and the spirits of Antichrist. He said, fear not, little children, praise God, for you've overcome them, for greater is he that's within you than he that's in the world. Dear church, God, when he saved you, he come into your heart, and God is almighty, all-powerful, and a great and mighty God. The Spirit of God, amen, can overcome anything in your life that attacks you. Can I get an amen? Come on, praise God.
Bless you, Lord.
Whether you're having temptations of meth, alcohol,
bless you, Lord.
Sex, drugs, God's still able to take care of it.
Amen.
You've been overcome. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
You've got the victory if you belong to
that's
God.
Right. Yes, right.
Amen.
Some people don't choose.
That's right.
I wonder just how big your God is. I wonder how big God is to people. He's big, ain't Colby.
Amen.
Got down to the last few breaths yesterday, didn't you? God wanted you here this morning for his glory, didn't he?
Amen.
He didn't let you drown, did he? Praise God, spared you one more time. Don't you realize that the mercies and the grace of God has kept you alive till today? Let me tell you what the purpose is for all this stuff. Now, I'm going to hush.
You get ready. We'll just have Sunday school the rest of the day. It's okay.
You know what Ephesians says? I said this many times, Jack. I've got two girls. I'm proud of my children. When they was little, my wife had to work a whole lot, and praise God. Amen. Sometimes I'd take them to business meetings at church, and they'd took to church every time the doors was open and all of through revival meetings. And hey man, I guess these two girls have heard more preaching, brother, than most Stiff Baptists in America today. And praise God, amen. I'm talking about hard preaching. It ain't been easy.
Amen.
You can ask them. I don't preach easy in my house. Matter of fact, I'm more stern about my Bible than my house than I am in this church. And if you can believe that, church, can I get an amen? Come on. Praise God. I want them to know the truth, and I want them to live a victorious life. I don't want them to be tricked by the things of the devil. But this is it. I want to preach this. Well, you don't care. I knew hang on for a moment. You said that. Listen to me. When they was little, when we went anywhere, amen? They were spotless when they got in the car. Their hair was combed perfect. Sometimes when I put it up, it didn't look so good, but I thought it looked pretty good. But I'd comb her hair, wash her face, I'd keep them clean, and then whenever people walked by, they'd say, oh, what pretty little girls. Whose little girls are you? And I'd say, praise God, they're mine. Can I get an amen? Somebody ought to know where I'm fixing to go with this. I'd say, praise God, they're mine. Amen. That's what God gave me. Ain't they beautiful or mine? Praise God, when God the Father looks down to this earth and he looks all over glory, he says, that's mine. Praise God, he's mine. She's mine. Look at her. When they say who do they belong to, God immediately says they're mine. I belong to him. They've been born. They're mine. Amen. Ephesians began to speak in the Word of God. He said the clay cleans them by the Word of God. By the water, which is the Word of God, to present them unto himself, a church without spot and blameless. You see, Now the Lord said, if my word offend thee, you're not my. There's a whole lot of evidence in this thing to tell you whether you belong to God or not.
Amen.
Apostle Paul fit the same battles we fight.
Amen.
Bible said he had a thorn in the flesh, and the thorn of the flesh, I believe, was the desires of the flesh.
Yeah.
The temptations, he warred like every other man. Paul wasn't a married man.
Bless him, Lord.
Come on.
That's right. Amen.
He didn't have a woman. He didn't have no relationship. So therefore, the devil fit him more than anybody else. And he went to God. And the devil came to buffet Paul with the thorn in the flesh. And he asked God, he said, Lord, said, remove this thorn. And God just looked at him and said, Paul, my grace is sufficient, son.
Amen.
Amen. You belong to me.
Amen.
You're mine.
Amen.
My grace is sufficient. He's got it, Diane. Amen. If you people had been here Wednesday night, you could have heard a message that would have got you through this mess. Amen.
Yeah, amen.
Praise God, we've quit believing God and started believing the circumstances of life. But praise God, according to the Word of God, all things are possible to them that believe. Can I get an amen? I'm talking about, praise God, when a man, woman, boy, or girl that believes God could say to that mountain to be removed, and if they believe and no doubt in their heart that God would move it, praise God, the Bible said God would pluck her up and cast it into the sea. Can I get an amen? I remember a time when the saints of God lived holy and lived for God, and they'd leave, praise God, the fields when they were working, all sweaty and dirty, and nobody had nothing, amen, sarcastic to say about them when they come tromping their feet off at the steps of the church because they came in a shouting. Can I get an amen? Because everybody come to worship God for what he had done for them. Can I get an amen? God had sent rain. God had delivered them. He fed their family, clothed their babies.
Yeah.
Glory.
Amen.
Let your old milk cow have a calf, amen, but get fresh for milk for them babies. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Said, Lord God, you want to see why God blessed us today, sister? The chickens are laying better than they ever have. Can I get an amen? Brother Gary said, God bless us. You want to see how them old hogs are growing. We'll have meat this winter. Can I get an amen? We forgot that America thinks it comes from a grocery store when all it comes from is the hand of an almighty God. Can I get an amen? And if God shuts heaven up, we're in trouble.
Amen,
brother. But America don't want to live for God. I'm going to hush. You see, my name's written.
Yeah.
And his name's written.
Yeah.
Mine's written in the name's Lamb's Book of Life, and his name's written in my forehead.
That's right.
You can't see it, but it's there. Huh? You can't see God, but he's there.
Amen.
I can feel him this morning. He's all around us, girl.
Amen.
We may have confused everybody, brother. There's one thing you better understand. When the Lord comes, you better be right with God.
Amen.
We've got into this thing, and I told somebody the other day, and you know, I don't like to put people on the spot. Well, sometimes I do. I'll just maybe I'll change that. Sometimes I do like to put people on the spot. People are so willing to compromise.
Yeah.
It's a compromising world we live in. And unless you ever stand up and say it's wrong, then people don't know that they're doing wrong. Can I get an amen? Somebody say amen.
Come on.
Huh? Come on. Talking about this stuff. 9-year-old children asking questions. And they don't know what to tell them. I'm talking about God's people. I said, my God, open up the book.
Yeah.
Amen.
If they're asking questions, tell them what the Bible said.
Amen.
Asking questions about being a homosexual. 9 years old. And people say to me, oh, it tires me up. People say to me, but I've got friends. How am I going to explain to them I've got friends that's homosexuals? I said, really? The Bible says you can be friendly, but you can't be friends with the world.
Amen.
For if you're friends with the world, you're an enemy of God. That's what the Bible said.
Amen.
There's a difference in being friendly and being partaker in sin. The Bible said to be not partaker in another man's sin. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
You cuddle up with this mess and praise God, just go and bring it in your house and say everything's okay. I'm friends with you. I'll be your friend. I'll be this and that. And then when that 9-year-old boy gets up 16-year-old and he decides he wants to be a homosexual because you've been their friend all your life, praise God, what are you going to say then? So I don't like that, preacher. I can't help it. I can read you the Bible. The Lord of God said this. That's what the Bible says. I don't where you stand. It don't make any difference to me. I'm here to preach you the book. I'm going home here in a few days. It don't matter to me.
Amen.
What are you going to do? What are you going to do? The Bible said this. They didn't do evil. Third chapter of the book of John. I will tell you where this is at. I ain't going to tell you what verse. I'm just going to tell you where it's at. You search it out. The Bible said they didn't do evil. Hate the light.
Yeah.
Anybody know who the light is? Somebody tell me.
Jesus.
Alright, they that do evil hateth Jesus. The Bible said they that do evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest their deeds should be reproved. Can I get an amen? Is that Bible? Somebody say amen. I'm reading for yourself. They that do evil hateth Jesus, and Jesus is my Lord. He's my Savior. He's my rock. He's my salvation. And I'm going to tell you straight up, straight to your face, if you hate him, praise God, you offend me. Can I get amen? Somebody say amen. We can love them into the Lord, but you can't be their best friend. Praise God. Now get a hold of that. So I ain't never seen it that way. That's Bible. Surely. I'm friendly to everybody. But I'm not going to partake in some of this mess. I'll help them. I'll lead them. I told a young man this week, I love with all my heart. I love these people. I'm not mad at these people. I love them. And I feel sorry because, praise God, somebody has lied. And if this brother goes on over in Revelation and he reads you to where there's no abominable thing going to enter into heaven, that means anything. That's talking about the abominations that makes desolate in the house of God. Not just walking down the streets, amen.
Amen.
Everybody wants to rally against these people. Hey man, let me tell you something. They got a soul and they need Jesus.
Amen.
But what about the liquor places?
Yeah.
How about the ABC store? What about the beer joints?
Amen.
Can I get an amen?
Amen.
How about the honky tonk? Somebody amen. Say amen. Does that not bother you?
That's right.
Amen. There's a little preacher told something we've been working with. And I get excited. And I'm a nut anyway. I'm not here for popularity. If you are, you're in trouble. Because they said they'd hate you for God's name's sake. That's what they said. If we live for Jesus, they're going to hate you. They're going to like you. People are not going to like you for telling the truth. Here just a little while back, hey man, people got so accustomed to this stuff, brother, that nobody cares. It's a joke. Everything's a joke to people. Do you know that? Here in the last little while in our little town of West Jefferson, they's going to bring in some adult entertainment, and they man some strippers and pole dancers and put them in a building up here in town, and everybody thought that was funny. It's a joke to people. And I even heard a preacher make a statement. I said, you've done got your liquor and your beer joints, so a little hoochie-coochie ain't going to bother you. Well, I'm sorry to say this to you, but the beer joints and the liquor joint bothers me.
Amen.
I'm not okay with it. When I quit drinking it, 7 years been like, sure I did. But I don't need it anymore.
Amen.
I'm done. I'm done with it. But I'm going to say this, and we'll have something to give away. I ain't no hurry. Praise God. If you're in a hurry, you're in trouble anyway. Listen to me. Them boys got to making fun. He's joking at work. At all days of life, and it was funny to everybody. I took about all I could stand, Jamie, and I just told him, I said, you hold on just a minute. I want to ask you people a question. The whole bunch of us are. I asked him, I said, how many of you boys got little girls you're going to find?
Amen.
You see, brother, it's funny whenever all this stuff's coming about when that baby's sitting on your lap. But when she gets 18 years old and 21 and, praise God, decides it's funny in dad's life, praise God, there wouldn't be nothing wrong with stripping in front of these old perverts. Praise God, then what are you going to say? Can I get an amen? It didn't become funny then. Praise God, let me tell you something. If you want them children to live holy in front of them.
Amen.
If you want them, praise God, to live for God at home, amen. Come on.
Amen.
I don't think it's funny. And then when all that happens and your baby's up there stripping and a pole dancing, and then you want the preacher to pray, then what are you going to do? Then how are you going to convince her that everything's okay? How are you going to convince her that this stuff's wrong that you liked about all these years in front of her? That it's a joke. I've got news for you. My life is not a joke. My God is not a joke.
Amen.
The standards of this Bible is not a joke. And when the Lord comes and He splits this sky wide open and His appearing comes and the trumpet sounds and the dead gets up, praise God, you'll see how serious it is, because these people are not going to be able to go.
That's right.
Amen.
Because they sin in their life. Now listen to me. You say, preacher, praise God, let me tell you something. We all fail to come short, but I'm going to tell you, unrepented sin will cause you to miss heaven. You've got to repent. Paul, the man of God that Paul was, the Bible said he died daily. He repented. That's what he meant.
Amen.
He gave up things. He quit things. Let me tell you something. When God saves you, you don't know everything. You're a baby in Christ. You're growing. So when you start to grow and you read this Word of God, you find something in this book that, amen, it convicts you of things that's in your life. You know what you've got to do? You've got to repent. Get out of it. Go on. Get up and believe the book.
Amen.
I'm going to hush. I've got a name. Hey, somebody's coming to me this morning. It's just unreal.
Bless you.
I love you, Jerry.
I love you, preacher.
The teaching this boy's a teaching, you better listen. That's when the Lord Jesus Christ appears, He's going to be looking for somebody.
Yeah.
He's going to be looking for those that belong to Him. Amen? And I'm so excited, sister, that whenever I hear the trumpet sound, I just want to shout, here I am, Lord. Huh? Here I am. Here I am. There's a little boy who used to come up with us all the time. Little bitty fella. Little colt and tail. Wildest little fella I've ever been in the woods with. It took four men to keep up with that boy. Little bitty fella. If there's a mud puddle, he's in waist deep. Hey man, if there's a briar patch, he's hung up on his hair. Was going to blow a water patch one night, and he was, now listen to me, and he was so hung up that he couldn't go. And his dad just kept going. He got way out ahead. And hey man, all of us little colt went to screaming. I said, Daddy! Daddy! Daddy turned around and said, what's the matter? He said, you forgot something. He said, what? He said, me! Hey man! Have you ever felt Billy Joe like, praise God, that God was so far away that you felt like He forgot about you? Anybody know what I'm preaching?
Amen.
And I just cry out, God, where are you? I'm here, Lord, don't forget me. I'm still here. God will just reach back and get you. Say, come on, son. Praise God, it's just a hindrance on your journey. Amen. Call me. Amen. Praise God, yesterday in that river, did you feel the one, amen, that reached down and picked you up? Praise God, kept you alive.
Amen.
Made it more real to you, didn't it?
Yeah.
Come on.
Bless you,
Lord. Thank you, Michael.
Oh, my golly days. You just hold on, bro. Stay right there. Somebody's going to get something.
My wife's a boy coming to my mind.
We walked for miles one night, come across and come out down here on Little Horse Creek, down there below your house, to go down to the higher elevator there, and you know how rough that country is. cut over timber, briars, my God, you can't crawl through it. Here we was, and that little old boy done walked on across the mountain, Jamie, and he's hung up in briars, he couldn't go. David told him, said, now come, and said, if you cry to go tonight, as rough as it is, he said, you're going to have to walk. You cannot. I ain't carrying you through this mess. All right, little boy was just trying to crawl across the logs and struggle just as far as he could struggle. You got in the greenbrier patch, and if you've ever been to the greenbrier patch, you don't get out of it. You don't care how big you are, how little you are. It had him hung from his britches legs to the top of his head, his little hair sticking up. And I got down there in that briar patch with him, and I got him loose. And I brought him on my back, and I carried him out of that mountain. He just come up to me, brother. And when he got home, his mom asked him, said, how'd he go, Colton? He said, Mom, I got hung up. But he said, the preacher carried me all the way out. Amen. Where would you be if it wasn't for men of God that loved you enough to tell you the truth and get you out of the briars and carry you to safety? Can I get an amen? Somebody ought to know what I'm preaching. Praise God, how many times have you been hung up and you just prayed for somebody to come by? I have been stuck. Trying to get there the best I could and get hung up. Just cross one obstacle. Now you're hung, sister. God just send somebody to pick you up, carry. Amen. My God, that's when it feels good. And then you can get to somewhere and say, my God, they carried me out. I'm ready. Amen. This brother's trying to carry you out. Teach it, brother. My God, go ahead and teach us. I'm excited. I'm going to thank you so much, but it starts with the blood of Jesus. When the Lord sees the blood, you got things bothering you, put them under the blood. Repent. Put them under the blood. Cover it with the blood. He'll take care of it. Jesus is the answer. I tell people, I sound like a broke record, brother, all the time. They'll say, what can I do, preacher? I said, call on Jesus. I said, but that won't work. I said, it works all the time. Just call on me. Amen. You just ain't need it bad enough. When you get to where you need Jesus more than you need the ungodliness of this world, then praise God, He'll help you. Can I get an amen? Come on. You got to be serious.
Amen.
Repenting means to get out of it. Turn away from it.
Amen.
When you're willing to get rid of it, praise God, the Lord will take care of it. I promise you that. I'm going to try to hush, Jerry. Praise God.
I got one verse. You ain't got to turn to it. 2 Timothy 2:19 says, nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal. The Lord knoweth them that are His, and let everyone that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity. That's just pretty well everything that's been said so far this morning. I keep thinking the way the Bible refers to that as being sealed. That we're here talking about the seal, and what I read in Revelation talking about the seal. You know, one thing about a seal, it's permanent. Nothing can change it. You know, I think about things in this world. If you seal something, or something's got a seal or a stamp or whatever on it, it's official. There's no two ways about it. When God seals you, there's no question about who you belong to. And it should be that way on your part and God's part. It should be you shouldn't be sitting here this morning questioning who you belong to. Because God's not questioning who you belong to. He knows. I thank God this morning for being sealed, for having that new name, having a newness of life. Being marked. You know, being marked ain't a bad thing. It's a good thing for us. I think about how I read over there that it talks about a new name and no man knows what it is. And you know, we call ourselves whatever. And I went back and read, and I believe it's Acts where it says that the apostles was first called Christians at Antioch. You know, that somebody recognized something about them. Give them a new name, call them something, give them a name. Call them Christian the first time.
Amen.
Anybody else got anything?
All bless you, Jesus. Bless you.
There's glory in my soul, since Jesus took control. He placed within my heart a happy song. The joy bells sweetly ring while I'm going there to I saw of salvation were silver and gold. All the poor of this world would be lost. But the Savior who loved us in mercy were told. Paid the price on the
soul.
He saves my soul. forget.
I'll never forget the day he came.
The day he came.
He makes me glad.
He makes me glad.
And I am sad.
His smile will say he is satisfied.
abide with me. I want my Lord to be satisfied with me. I want my life to be what it had been me. Then when I come to that great eternity, it's my will say he is satisfied with me.
Hey, look, can you read it? Number 8.
Troubles and trials often betray us, causing the weary body to stray, but we shall walk beside the still waters with the leading the way, going up on to living green pastures, where we shall live and die evermore. Even the Lord will be. Heavenly shore, those who have strayed were sought by the Master. He who once gave his life for the sheep out on the mountain, still he is searching, bringing them in for ever to keep, going up on to living green pastures, where we shall live and die evermore.
Now I'm an erring child of God, I truly
It's a grand and glorious feeling. Just to be a child of God. Now His love comes over me, stealing. Talking with my King,
with my King.
Jesus is mine, and to His hand I'm ever clinging. I'm so glad I plunged beneath the crimson flood. As the fret's on the onward way, my soul is singing. It's a grand and glorious feeling as I go. It's a grand and glorious feeling, just to be a child of God. How His love comes over me, stealing, making my pathway brighter, grow as all my thought. Every day of His love, I'll ever sing. What a grand and glorious feeling, just to be walking and to be talking with my King. Happy am I along the way to life eternal. Jesus saved and washed my soul as white as snow. Some of these days I'll reach my wondrous home supernal. It's a grand and glorious feeling as I go. It's a grand and glorious feeling, just to be stealing, making my pathway brighter, grow as all I've got. Every day I'll tell the old story of His love I'll ever sing. What a grand and glorious feeling. Just to be walking and be talking with my King.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just want to thank You for another great opportunity, God, to be back at Your house again today. Father, for the blessings You give us this week. God, You've been so good to us, Lord. Just reach down and touch each one that's here today. Father, should be one, Lord, that don't know You in a free pardon of sin. Father, that just slipped away. Lord, just bring them back, God. Give them what they need, Father. We know, Lord, this could be their last opportunity, Father. If those in the community, Lord, don't know You, God, we know there are many, Father, just reach down and touch them. Help this little church to be a light on the hill, Father, if people could see a difference in the life that we live, God, and want what we've got, Lord. Just take the money, Lord, and use it the way You'd have it to be used, Father. God, be with those in the hospitals and the rest homes, and those that's lost loved ones this week, Father, we know there are many, Lord. God, just give them the strength they need, Father, to get through. Lord, be with Brother David in the after service. God, just pour it out from on high. God, give Him the words You'd have Him to say in us accepting hearts, Lord, to understand, Father. We ask it all in the holy and precious name. Amen.
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 see you brought your gift off.
Your church and your singers. I'm for it. I don't know where you're at. I'm just
He's never too tired.
Go ahead.
Wherever I go, he's always been there. If your God is dead, or if he is sleeping, he may be
There's a bright sun somewhere. There's a bright sun somewhere. Don't you rest until you find.
Thank you. Eternal,
and riches. That's a wrap for Lady K. From seas to day, the heavenly treasures, they will never pass away. Changing hand. Hold to his hand, to God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. And when your journey is completed, have been true, fair and bright, the home in glory, pure and righteous, so will be.
Come on
and hold to his hand, to God's unchanging hand. Hold to his hand, to God's unchanging hand. Eternal, hold to God's unchanging hand.
You get ready, Father, for a second. I got something I want to say, and then I don't know if I'll preach or not. This is what God said to Ruth. Now, I don't understand everything God does. I don't understand a lot of things. Matter of fact, I know that all we need is more of Jesus. We need more of Jesus. And I do know that in this lifestyle we live, praise God, in all this world we live, there's still people that's striving to do right. There's still people that, praise God, want a new beginning, Jamie. They still people that, praise God, want to do better. These people, praise God, that need help. Amen. This is what God said to read. I want to read this to you. This world makes out like God throws his people away. The Bible said, God said, should I forsake my people? He said, God forbid. Amen. God has never forsaken one. He's never left one. He's never thrown one away. And I want to read this to you before they read or sing about God's amazing grace, brother. This is what God said. God spoke to my heart. I had a whole different message going to preach this morning. Amen. This is what God said. Sixth chapter of the book of John. I want to read this. You're going to have to turn to it. I want to read it to you. And I want you to listen to what God's Word says. Even God's people get downhearted and they get discouraged sometimes. Amen. People get discouraged. That's just the way it is. You're in the flesh and you're fighting battles that nobody else knows about, even in your mind and in your flesh. And you need help. Amen. But praise God, if you want a closer walk with Jesus, you'll never get it sitting back and wondering how it's going to be closer. You've got to come to Jesus. Can I get an amen? You don't get what you need by sitting back and waiting on God to pour it on you. He invites you to come and get it. Amen. If you're hungry, come and dine. If you're thirsty, come and drink. If you need help in the time of trouble, look unto the hill from which cometh our help. Can I get an amen? Come on, son. Somebody knows what I'm talking about. Somebody's heart this morning has a desire for the things of God. And you don't know whether God accepts you or not. Honey, let me tell you something. God, if he's going to throw somebody away, I would have been the one he'd have got rid of. The Bible said this. Jesus said in the 35th verse, 6th chapter of the book of John, this is what God said to read. And he said to read it before you and sat down. The Bible said, and Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh, amen, to me shall never hunger. Amen. And he that believeth on me shall never thirst. But I said unto you that ye also have seen me and believe not. And all that the Father giveth to me shall come to me. And that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. That's the verse that came.
sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day. But the Bible said, all that the Father give unto me, they will come unto me, and in no wise will I cast one out. Now I want to tell you something this morning. If you need help, I know where you can get it. It's in Jesus. It's through it by the amazing grace of God. It's by His grace that we're all here this morning. It's by His grace that everything's as good as it is. And thanks be to God, He sent down deliverance this morning through the Son. Amen.
Right, amen.
You can have it. The Bible said over there, Moses chose to suffer the affliction with God's people than the pleasure to sin for a season, as though he saw the invisible God. My mind went back to a time in my barn. Brother Keith Rourke was there. We were praying for a young man. Prayed for him for many years. He's in and out of prison. We'd go to him and talk to him, witness to him. And amen, even the parole officer told him, you see, it's not a coincidence that you're in the house of God this morning. God wants you to where you can hear about a man called Jesus. This man told me, he called me, he said, preacher, can I go to church with you? I said, sure, he only come get you. He said, my parole officer said if I didn't get in church, he's going to send me back to prison. Amen, and praise God, he never would go to church with me. Sure, nowhere else, so he went back to prison. It wasn't long till he got back out. I prayed for him night and day. And one evening in my barn, Jamie, praise God, amen, I had the door shut and I heard the squeaking of the brakes. And praise God, I knew who it was before I ever opened the door. Because you see, I done called on God. And when I slid the door open, there he stood. It was late in the night and I asked him, I said, son, what are you doing out so late? Amen. He said, preacher, I've been to Alcoholics Anonymous. He said, I'm not an alcoholic. He said, I'm a drug addict. He said, I need to get off of the drugs. I said, do you really want off of them drugs? He said, I sure do. He said, why? I said, because I know a man that 20-some years ago, I said, he helped me with alcoholism. I said, I know a man 20-some years ago, met him, amen, became my best friend. I said, he's helped many a young person to get off of the drugs and the addictions of this world. Made a new creature, give them a new life, walked with them till they got things right, and still walking with them today.
Amen.
He said, do you think he can help me? I said, you better believe he can. He's never thrown one away, never come to him. You can tell he's hooked. He wanted to know, amen, who it was. So I just went to talking about an old horse I had in the barn. You mentioned, you stopped me. He said, wait a minute, preacher. He said, you didn't tell me who this fellow was. Well, I said, this is the way it works. Now listen to me close. I said, this man's my best friend. I can recommend him in all walks of life. I can recommend him, praise God, for anything that you need. Amen. I can recommend this friend. And I said, not only will he be my friend, but he'll be your best friend too. You see, he's a friendly man. He's a man of love and compassion. Hey, man, come on, I'm about to fly, praise God. And I told him, I said, he can help you. And I just went back to talking again. He stopped me again. He said, preacher, I got to know who this man is. I said, do you really want a new life? Do you really want the change? He said, I sure do.
I said, I'm going to introduce you to my best friend right tonight. He said, can I call him? The Bible said, whosoever's called upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Woo! Yeah, this is kind of important. Come on!
Amen.
Shoo! I said, my best friend's name is Jesus Christ the Lord. Amen? And he just looked at me and turned as white as a sheet. This is what he said, Scott. He said, I got to go. I said, that's exactly what I thought. You ain't serious. I'm preaching for somebody that's serious this morning.
That's right.
Do you want to change? Do you want a new life? Do you want to come with Jesus?
Amen.
Now, come on. Do you want the things of God in your life? Jamie, it changed you, didn't it? Amen. It took prison, but praise God, the Lord never said to tell you this morning. He's faithful to his word, and there's a promise that God made young people, old people, middle-aged people. He's never thrown nobody away. They've never been too ungodly, never been too unrighteous, never been lost too far that God would throw one away.
Amen.
You see, the blood of Jesus cleanses.
Makes new creatures out of it. I'm going to hush. That's what God said. God said to give you an opportunity. That's what he said. That's what he said to preach this morning.
He said, I'll never throw you away. Would you come? The preacher, I just wasn't sure of it. Would you come? Do you need help this morning with your troubles in life? Would you come? You see, Jesus faced it all, every bit of it.
Amen.
So you can be an overcomer. Everything you're going through today, everything that's in your mind, Jesus Christ dealt with it. So you can have victory. That's how good God is.
Amen.
Come on. He's never thrown one away. Somebody's been thinking about, amen, walking with Jesus.
Somebody's been thinking about coming back to God. Somebody's been thinking about giving your life wholly to Jesus. Amen. You've tried everything else. I tried everything in this world. Nothing satisfied me. Nothing. You know how you feel on the inside? You're miserable this morning. You're not happy. There's no peace, sir. There's a turmoil. There's a battle. You feel it every day when you get up. It's a struggle to even get out of bed sometimes. The Lord said, come. I won't throw you away. And this is the promise of God. He said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you, and I will go with you to the end of this world. While we sing about God's amazing grace, would you come? God said, give you an opportunity this morning. What's troubling you? Would you come? You don't have to leave this church the same way.
Amen.
There's a fellow told me, I'm going to tell you this. He called me one evening. I used to hunt a whole lot with my dad.
Amazing grace.
He said, preacher, I just want you to know.
By the way of grace, come on, praise God.
locked up in sin's prison, but set us free. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Come and trust Him, Mr. Lord. Just give it all to Him. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. I'll tell you right now, this thing ain't over.
Well, I need Jesus.
I know this man. He's my best friend. He can be your best friend.
Yes.
You know what's so sad about it? These people, amen, sit right in the congregation and people with things on their hearts that they can't carry. And they struggle with it every day. And the Lord said, give it to me and I'll carry it for you. Amen.
I stood in the courtroom.
Listen.
Judge turned my way. Looks like you're guilty.
Never been guilty.
Now what do you say?
Listen.
I spoke up, Your Honor. I have no doubt. defense, but that's when mercy walked in. Mercy walked in and pleaded my case. Called to the stand, God saving grace. The blood was presented that covered my sin.
Sing it, friend. Come on, Miss Smart.
And wondered how this could be, that someone so guilty could still be set free. My chains were broken. I've been born again, forgiven when mercy walked in. Mercy walked in and pleaded my case. Called to the stand, God's saving grace. The blood was presented that covered my sin. Forgiven when mercy walked in.
Yeah. Let me tell you something. The Bible says that if you'll confess the Lord Jesus with your mouth and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. And he goes on to say that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Let me tell you just a little something about me, and then I'm going to just sit down and hush. I'm done. You guys, somebody get you a song. I ain't keeping you here all day. When I first got saved, I'd never been took to church. Didn't know a thing about church. And man, if you're here today and your family's bringing you to church, you ought to thank God. Yeah, I didn't know nothing about it. Never on the Bible. I got an old wore out Bible, Jamie, in my house. You've seen me carry it a million times. That's the first Bible I ever owned. That's the one they give me whenever God saved me. That's the one I preached out of when God called me to preach. I wore the pages off of it. I've got it duct taped together and laid behind my recliner on the shelf. Amen. Come on. It's a mile marker. You see, when I'm gone, there's kids that's come into my life. When I'm gone, amen, my girls can take this old Bible that I marked the scriptures down and find heaven. These children, amen, it was a running sheep yesterday. When they get hungry for the things of God, they can take that old Bible and they can read it and they can find the place called heaven. I didn't know nothing about God, didn't know nothing about how to pray, didn't know nothing about the church. But all I know is that Friday night I was a lost man without God. And the preachers kept crying out, come on and talk to Jesus and he'll help you and all this. I didn't know how to pray. The devil said, you don't have to pray. How are you going to get through it? Let me tell you what got me into the throne room of God. First of all, it's a humble heart. Amen.
It's a broken heart, a contrite spirit. I was troubled and I needed help. When I fell down on my face that night, praise God, and I felt just like some people do today. I just wanted to run. I didn't know what to do. When God touched me, I couldn't run. If God ever touches you, you can't never get away. You'll never forget the touch of God. I don't care where you go in this life or who you meet. You'll never forget that touch of God. But that night, an old alcoholic, lost without God, unlovable, and unsaved, fell down on his face, and the only thing that would come out of my mouth when I cried out was, God help me. God help me. And then simple words brought heaven to me. Huh? God help me. Help came, brother. Save my soul. I ain't always been what I should have been.
but I ain't never been the same. I'm going up, praise God.
That's the message God said to preach.
He changed my whole mind. I think God's good this morning. Those that came to Jesus knows what I'm talking about. I've got a friend. Best friend I've ever had. His name's Jesus. Met him one Friday night 20 some odd years ago. He's been there in the hard times, the good times. He's been through everything. Never left me. Been there when my family was sick. Been there when my mama's been sick. He's been there through all the troubles in life. Hard times. Good times. He's always been there. Always will. So you see, you got an opportunity. You can have it if you want it. Told a fellow the other day, he's going to tell you this, coming back. I get excited about a lot of things, but not. And I'll tell you just like I tell everybody else. What you believe and how you live don't affect me a bit on what I believe. I'm saved by the grace of God washed in the blood of the Lamb. My name's written in the Lamb's book of life. And what you do don't affect my salvation. I've got a relationship with Christ. My job is to lead you to a man who can help you. Amen. And if you want it, I can help you. I can take you to him. I can lead you to him. I can praise God for you. But if you don't want it, I can tell you what I can do. I love you. Pray for you. And I'm going home without you. And one day I'm leaving, bud. Amen. And it's almost here. There's an excitement in the air. Say it's a bad time. No, it's an exciting time. Because you've seen the Word of God fulfilled. The thing that's happening in America today has brought forth the truth of the Word of God. I'm going to hush. It's been a good time to be. I love you. Somebody get you a song. We're going to fellowship. You want to pray? We're going to fellowship. Pray for those that's in the hospital, those that's having hard times. Pray for our lost. Pray for people that's not ready to leave this world. Pray for one another, the Bible said. Pray without ceasing. Pray you for one another. Everybody in this church has got troubles of some kind. Everybody. We need one another. We need to help one another. But this morning, if you're here this morning, you're lost without God. I pray to God you think about what's been said, because this thing's about over. And I'd like you to go to heaven on this. Amen. And if you're here this morning, you're a child of God. Go back to believing God. Even though it sounds crazy, go to believing God, because God, amen, will respect and honor them that believe. He'll answer your prayers, I promise you. Amen. You got people in trouble? Believe God on their behalf. I'm going to hush, get you a song.